உங்கள் காரை சிறந்த தரத்தில் சிறப்பு சலுகையில் சர்வீஸ் பண்ணணுமா? உடனே 5K கார் காருக்கு வாங்க.
விவிடி தமிழர்களின் பாரம்பரிய மிக்க விவிடி ஹேர் ஆயில் நேச்சர்ஸ் கிஃப்ட்.
See, my morning starts with I basically watch porn and then I watch Donald Trump's latest news. That's because I'm very interested in the US politics.
So how did Mia Malkova come into the project?
See, I mean, it's an open secret. I always say that I watch porn and I saw her there first. I like gangster films. I like skin show in women. And something out of the box, in my view.
How do you feel when people address you as the controversial filmmaker?
I used to look up to the bullies in class. You know, these bullies used to pull hair and make some kind of sounds, and that used to create some kind of a violence by the teacher beating them up or something like that. So that drama I used to enjoy. So I think those are little short films I was making in my head in my school days. I know I sound like a criminal. So the sound will take a huge importance with that regard, and that is what I think Rehman's contribution was. So because of making this film Rangira, I wanted that kind of sound which only Rehman could have created.
Hello sir, welcome to the show.
Hi.
So Climax is releasing on June 6th. Can you tell us about the movie? What is Climax about and how did you get the idea?
See, generally horror films are made in dark places, like, you know, abandoned bungalows and maybe some kind of haunted house on the top of a hill. So I thought if I place a horror film in a desert where the eye can see forever, there's no corners or something where you can hide. So I that was my first thought, to make a horror film in a desert. And if a couple comes and then they get caught in a strange, weird situation, and we journey along with them as an audience. So that was my initial thought of Climax.
So how did Mia Malkova come into the project?
See, I mean, it's an open secret. I always say that I watch porn and I saw her there first. And I felt I wanted someone like, would be comfortable with wearing such clothes in such large open spaces. No, like a desert. I mean, you expect something like those clothing to happen in indoors or something like that. So it was just like, and as long as a American woman comes to a desert along with her boyfriend and she's faced. So I thought, because I know her in a sense from her videos, obviously, and that's why I cast her.
So you've always been innovative. You have bought now RGV's world, and you are the one to bring Steadicam to Indian cinema. But talking about the RGV's world, when people are subscribed to monthly or yearly subscriptions in OTT platforms, have you ever thought of the risk of giving a pay-per-view concept? Do you think that will work in some extent?
Yeah, I mean, I thought about it a lot. My basic common sense tells me if someone is going to buy a ticket for a film in a theater, why won't they do that on the internet? The question is about whether the content they're interested in watching. That is what we determine that. So if they're not interested in the content, they would neither come to the theater nor pay for it online, you know. So that is one aspect. And second is, I feel the future is about, it becomes more an expression. Why I'm calling it RGV World is because it will have content of my sensibility. It almost becomes an extension of my mind, the kind of subject matters which interest me. It might have a varied genre. It can be erotic or violence or horror, something challenging the existing norms. So it is more like a personality reflection. I think there is a future, because any kind of a maker would like to express himself without the least filtration or loss in translation, where he wants to reach the end viewer. And that is what your personal platform can achieve that. And second point is, as far as subscribers are concerned, the people, it might take time. I'm not expecting it to happen overnight. But at the end of the day, you go to a platform, not really for the platform, you go for the content. Like, for example, when I first went on to Netflix, I heard so much about Narcos. And I wanted to see that show, and which is the reason I subscribed to Netflix. So after that, of course, I would have discussed so many other great things happening on that. So I think everyone has to have a start. And my intention is to make a lot of content for RGV World, and also, not apart from me, I also want to I mean, put in content made by others as long as it kind of matches my sensibility or whatsoever.
And you were talking about the reflection of your personality and mentioning erotic or violent films. So how does that relate to your personality, sir?
So I'm saying in my sensibility, I don't like rom-coms, for example. I don't like much family dramas. I don't like films on devotional films, for example, or sports. So what I like unabashedly is what I like gangster films, for example. I like skin show in women. I like thriller, whatever you call it, suspense, psychological thriller, stuff like that. And something out of the box, in my view. So I think only those will be made or released in RGworld.in because it almost becomes a personalized brand, a personalized theater, where you will get to know, and you go to some specific restaurant, it makes some specific kind of food. I think it is an equivalent of that.
So you've done films in Hindi, you've done films in Telugu, even in Kannada, but you have not done a film in Tamil. But you are so indirectly connected to the Tamil film industry because you've introduced two important people from this industry to Bollywood. One is A.R. Rahman, another one is Surya. So what was going on your mind and how did you come to the decision to pull them to the Bollywood Hindi film fraternity?
I never saw the language as a point because, see, kind of Killing Veerappan, I did it because of my interest in Veerappan. So whether he was whichever language wouldn't have mattered. And the source material on Veerappan I got from some contacts in Karnataka, which is the reason I've chosen to do a Kannada film. And I'm a great fan of Surya as an actor. And I really want to do a Tamil film sometime. Let's see now.
What about Rahman sir? Rahman sir was so, he was talking so positively about your decision to bring him to Hindi cinema with Rangila. He was talking about Rangila experiences. He was so fascinated with the way you get work. So how was it working with Rahman?
Yes, Rahman is like a true, I would say, visionary music director, which everyone knows. I don't need to say it now. So when I heard the tracks of what he made in his first films, like Roja to Gentleman, to those movies, I could see that this man is a guy who creates sound which has not been heard before. See, melodies many can do. I'm not taking that away from the great music directors who compose fantastic melodies. But the sound which he created, something no one heard. And I give a lot of importance to sound because the kind of the unusual pattern of grooves what he uses and the sounds, I mean, that forced the director to create a visual which has not been seen before. It forced the choreographer to compose a movement which has not been seen before. So the sound will take a huge importance with that regard. And that is what I think Rahman's contribution was. So because of making this film Rangila, a kind of a musical, I wanted that kind of sound which only Rahman could have created. Yeah.
Okay, now give us some insight about this cool RGV. What does he do in a normal day when he is not filming?
I'm most of the time busy in some kind of film work, be it shooting or editing. For example, in the entire lockdown period, I just finished shooting Enter the Girl Dragon, the martial arts film. I have been doing some post and editing work of that. Then I finished shooting of Coronavirus. And then I now just now finished a short film called Naked. Okay. And then I'm preparing for another film to be made now called Lockdown. So pretty much I'm very tied up and I'm rarely there without any work. But if I have to say it, and probably I would say, see, my morning starts with, I basically watch porn and then I watch Donald Trump's latest news. That's because I'm very interested in the US politics. And then I do some viewing on the latest technology in cinema, whatever has come. And then I read up on probably the current events which are happening across the country or the world. Yeah, pretty much I spend about an hour to hour and a half on these things, what I mentioned. And then almost it's work, continuous work it will be. And then in the night, I have a couple of workouts. And intermediate, whenever I get a time, whenever something excites me, I'll put a tweet out. So that's pretty much the my work day.
Very interesting. your interest in underworld is can be seen in your films, in your books, in your biography. You've titled Guns and Thighs. So what is it that you're so obsessed with this underworld thing?
I mean, I basically I'm interested in anything which is out of normal. I mean, if the whole life is happening exactly in a way, and it becomes boring, and someone, some character or some situation kind of challenges that normalcy and puts it in a certain disarray, I'd like to examine that. I mean, that is what cinema finally is about. Cinema is always about conflicts, you know, in whichever way. So the larger the conflict, or I mean, the larger the interest.
And you had said that it all started with the bullies in your class when you were in school. So the interest in the interest in gangsters and things. So that's what I started.
Yeah, I was kind of very. I used to look up to the bullies in class because I used to hate my studies, and the only entertainment in the classroom were these bullies who used to pull hair and hit the teachers with a chalk piece from the back bench and make some kind of sounds and all that. So they used to disrupt the order, and that used to create some kind of a violence by the teacher beating them up or something like that. So that drama I used to enjoy. So I think those are little short films I was making in my head in my school days. I know I sound like a criminal, but the point is that's the truth, you know.
How do you feel when people address you as the controversial filmmaker? Because I've been going through articles where before your name they address, they put this thing.
They use that word almost like a habit without even knowing the meaning of controversy. See, controversy is what? Primarily, if you say something strongly, if there are enough people, there might be people who agree or maybe people who disagree, and it will start a dialogue, which is pretty much what happens in any conversation. If you, from the morning to night, if you look at the news cycles or whatever it is, people keep on conflicting with each other. People keep on contradicting with each other. So to that extent, any conversation eventually will be some form of a controversy, which can happen in between three people, which can happen in hundreds or thousands or lakhs of people. End of the day, but the bottom line is conversation by definition is exchanging of ideas, and many times they might not be agreeable to some people, which is what technically creates a controversy. But without controversy, society cannot function. Even change comes from that, advancement comes from that.
And most of those people say that because of your tweets, I guess. So what exactly goes on in your mind before you put out such tweets?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't see whether it says something or it tweets something, it's coming from the same way. I don't think there's a fundamental difference, because eventually tweet is nothing but an expression. You're expressing yourself in a way. Yeah. You're saying, for example?
Yeah, for example, when Prime Minister asked people to light candle, you lit up a cigarette.
Yeah. For me, my job is as an entertainer. You know, okay, so I would say, like, you know, if you are present to me, you're not a journalist, I probably will be joking with you, okay? And in terms of, if I'm a storyteller doesn't mean just a story. Even the aspect of me lighting the cigarette, it just created probably more news than people lighting candles, because that is expected, this is unexpected.
So that's all a result of your want to entertain people, is it? Even your tweets.
Yeah, I'd like to provoke a reaction in people, not necessarily for the good. I mean, I might enjoy irritating someone also.
And we should definitely talk about coronavirus. When people are struggling to make a short film, some of the filmmakers were doing short films. But what made you, how did you pull off such a big feature film in this time, in this situation?
See, for me, I got the idea of the virus, coronavirus film, the day Narendra Modi announced the lockdown. Okay. I just thought it was a family, and in the lockdown, to make a family film. And for me, it is almost like a thriller horror film. In a horror film, there's an unseen ghost. And in this film, there's an unseen virus. And pretty much both of them are scary, because they can create health or death. Damage or death for that matter. Okay. So I thought a very dysfunctional family who probably don't like each other, and for various reasons, now they're forced to live with each other in the lockdown period. And now the coronavirus lurking in the background, and they don't know who it is going to infect and if it has infected somebody, but they do not have escape to go out. So that is what the idea was. And then when I floated this idea to some actors I know, And I said, the very fact, the store itself forces you to be in a social distance and take extreme measures of sanitizers, blah, 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 all that. That is a part of the story, because the story is happening in the lockdown. You know? Then the crew members, all of them, I told them the same thing, and it's being shot indoors in home. So pretty much we can easily follow the so-called guidelines. You know? So all those were followed. And wherever we had to have some kind of a close contact with the actors, we used a certain degree of CG to achieve that.
Right. In which platform will coronavirus be released?
Not yet decided. Probably it might go on a platform. I mean, I'm talking to 2-3 people, so let's see.
And most of the films these days take almost a year to complete and come out. But you have mentioned almost 4-5 projects going on. So you complete a project very soon. So how does that happen? And this trend of taking so long for a film, is it healthy for the industry?
I mean, I can't speak for others, but like in the words of Stephen King, when someone asked him, how do you write so fast? Because he's written so many novels in his career. He said, I don't write fast, others write slow, you know. So, I mean, I know it is a kind of a smart statement to make, but the point is, I do only films all the time, and by nature I take decisions very fast, and I have wonderful teams constantly working parallelly with me on various projects.
And two of your trilogies were a big hit and very popular for the authenticity. One is the political trilogy and the another one is the gangster trilogy. So coming to the gangster thing, Danny Boyle was so inspired by your films that he made Slumdog Millionaire. He has stated that in an interview. So how do you bring that authenticity in gangster films? So can you recall some experiences that you had in the R&D work for those films?
See, when I made Satya, a lot of people, including some cops, were convinced that I know the gangsters in real. Otherwise, there's no way I could have captured that kind of authenticity. But my question is, if they think it's so real, how will the audience know it's real? They also never met the gangsters. You know what I'm saying? See, if they think it's real, because but how do they know that's real? How do they know it? That's because people empathize with realistic characters. So when they see a realistic character, whether it's in a gangster world or some business world or some world, they will think it's a real film. Film is not real because you know the reality. It's about creating characters which seem realistic. Like a Vikku Mathre and Satya, for example, is an aggressive guy. He is like a very uncontrollable, impulsive guy. Now, that guy happened to be a gangster in Satya, but the same character, if he was in the construction business, he would have been an aggressive supervisor on the labor. So I don't see much of a difference. So I think knowing people, understanding people, and trying to recreate them in film is what creates the authenticity. That is not to say I've never met gangsters, I've never interacted with them. Most of my interaction with them happened post Satya and Company, because they like those films so much and they want to come and meet me.
Oh, that's interesting. People might think the other way around, that you first met the gangsters and then made the films. But this is...
It happened in the reverse. Correct.
Nice talking to you, sir. It was a pleasure. All the best for the film, Climax.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. உங்கள் காரை சிறந்த தரத்தில் சிறப்பு சலுகையில் சர்வீஸ் பண்ணணுமா? உடனே 5K கார் கார்க்கு வாங்க.
விவிடி தமிழர்களின் பாரம்பரியமிக்க விவிடி ஹேர் ஆயில் நேச்சர்ஸ் கிஃப்ட்.